I am pleased to give you my greetings, the greetings to the speakers, Mary Jo Bang, Francesco Ciabattoni, and Vittorio Montemaggi, and to many participants in this webinar dedicated to Dante, searcher and discoverer. This is part of the series of webinar, Questioni di Civiltà, organized jointly by Georgetown Representative Office in Rome and La Civiltà Cattolica, two Jesuit institutions. I am Debora Tonelli, Georgetown representative in Rome, and I welcome you also on behalf of Father Antonio Spadaro, director of La Civiltà Cattolica. I would like to thank the co-sponsor of this initiative, the Global Engagement, Berkley Center for Religion, Peace and World Affairs, Georgetown Humanities Initiative, Club of Italy. And of course, I would like to thank our colleagues who supported us in making it possible, Ruth Gopin, Yvonne Quick, Shimen Tong, Amy van der Blit. I would like briefly introducing this webinar by offering a simple and brief framework for the discussion. When Paul and I talked about the possibility of organizing this initiative, we agreed that Dante is not a figure of the past and neither just an Italian poet. The Sommo Poeta is the source of a continuous inner rebirth. Through him and with him is possible to walk the path of the soul. As Pope Francis said, through his immortal works, still has much to say and offer to those who desire to travel the way to true knowledge, to the authentic discovery of self, of the world, of life's profound and transcendent meaning. His constant spiritual search for the meaning of existence makes Dante a poet able to triumph over time, to cross the space, and to transcend religious boundaries through a Catholic outlook at once distinctive and universal. Dante is at the same time many things: an Italian 14th century poet who tells his time and doesn't fear to argue his political thought, a fervent Christian, an universal poet for his capability of touching men and women of every time and culture. Dante lends himself to be known by scholars of different fields: literature, theology, music, arts, history, philology, and by whoever wanted to walk the path of the truth. The last 10 popes have honored Dante's memory and his value for the Catholic tradition. Leo XIII, for example, inserted Dante in his project for the restoration of the Thomist roots of Dante's theological reflection. Benedict XV honored Dante with the encyclical In Preclara Summorum of 1921, but it was Paul VI who joined the personal cult of Dante's poetry with the explicit official recognition of its doctrinal value for the whole church and for the Christian humanism, as testified by his apostolic letter Altissimi Cantus. But Dante is more than a Christian poet, and the idea of an intersection between theology and poetry in the Commedia is still uncontroversial. The differentiation between poetry and non-poetry, form and content, poetry and theology, is still open. In any case, Dante's images are still the source of our imaginaries, and, as already said, his importance transcends religious and Italian boundaries. This interest in Dante is sanctioned, first of all, by the number, the dimensions, and the scientific standards of the collected volumes produced, characterized by many perspectives and focused on different topics. The love story between the English-speaking world and Dante began with Geoffrey Chaucer, the father of English poetry, in the 14th century. Chaucer acknowledges Dante's absolute precision and omnipotence in writing. His judgment was confirmed by Coleridge, Eliot, and many other English-speaking scholars. Dante's influence spread through the world, and today we have the opportunity to broaden our horizons. Enjoy our webinar. Thank you to all for being here with us today.
Thank you very much, Debora. I'm Paul Eli, Senior Fellow in the Berkley Center. And Debora and I have had the pleasure of organizing a number of these events together. And it's a special pleasure to organize one on Dante because of his stature and because of the stature of the people we have here with us, the poet and translator Mary Jo Bang, the scholar Vittorio Montemaggi, and the scholar and Georgetown colleague of ours, Francesco Ciabattoni. I'm humbled to be hosting an event on Dante, and humbled especially in the presence of you as Italians, as Italian speakers, as people who have devoted yourselves, even consecrated yourselves to Dante in such a significant way. I'm just a fellow traveler, and yet I'm, as a fellow traveler, emboldened in the way that I think the text of the Commedia does to us. It invites us to not only to accompany Dante on his journey, but to identify his journey with our own and vice versa. So I've tried to do so in a small way in my own work, and I hope that that can somehow inform the conversation that we have today. Thanks again to all of you who are here, and thanks to all in the audience. It seems apt to me that we would begin with Dante and the words of Dante himself, at least in English translation. Mary Jo, would you open things by giving us a few lines from your rendition of Dante?
Thank you. Yes, I'll read the first few lines of my canto one. Stopped mid-motion in the middle of what we call our life, I looked up and saw no sky, only a dense cage of leaf, tree, and twig. I was lost. It's difficult to describe a forest, savage, arduous, extreme in its extremity, I think, and the facts come back, then the fear comes back. Is that enough?
It's striking. I mean, Dante is always striking, but I'm struck especially hearing the passage you just read that Dante says it's difficult to describe a forest. Now, this is the best describer in the history of world literature, Dante, right? So if Dante finds it difficult to describe a forest, we should really take notice. You are a poet, you are a translator, you're a professor at Washington University in St. Louis. The word encounter figures into Professor Montemaggi's work, but your own encounter with Dante that led you to undertake the translation of the Inferno and then now of the Purgatorio is a dramatic story, one that's very striking. How did it come about?
In 2005, I was reading a book by the experimental poet and sound artist, Carolyn Bergvall, who lives in Britain. And she had created a work, she actually created it first as a sound piece, although I didn't know that at the time because I was reading it in a book she had published in 2003. And it was called Via 48 Dante Variations. What she had done was to go to the British Library and take down all of the translations of the Inferno that were on the shelves. And it turned out there were 47 of them. She, at the top of the page, put the original Italian, and then she began to arrange these first lines in tercets. Some were prose translations, but she would keep the three-line configuration. And she arranged them not chronologically, but alphabetically by the first word of the first line. She appended each one with the name of the translator, last name only, and the date. And it was a fascinating found poem, a fascinating construction, because it has that element of repetition and revision, and it becomes rather incantatory after a while. And it's available online, Carolyn Bergvall, Via. And if you listen to it, it's just mesmerizing. And I thought I would read just the first couple of entries so that you could see how it works. Along the journey of our life halfway, I found myself again in a dark wood wherein the straight road no longer lay. Dale, 1996. At the midpoint in the journey of our life, I found myself astray in a dark wood, for the straight path had vanished. Craig and Hollander, 1989. Half over the wayfaring of our life, since missed the right way, through a night dark wood, struggling, I found myself. Musgrave, 1893. And it goes on and on. I was fascinated by several things. One, that there is no right way to carry over those three relatively simple lines in the Italian, because these 47 people didn't know each other, of course, and they're writing at different times, and they don't see how everybody else has made these word choices. And yet none of them are identical. None of them are the same. And that struck me. The other thing that struck me was how elevated the language was, that in fact, the ones that were translated in the 1800s were as elevated as those translated in perhaps 2000, the year that she was making the poem. And I wondered what would happen, since we already have all of these existing translations, if someone took the translation and put it into colloquial speech. And yet, because this was a poem, and because poems use sound as an expressive element, I also tried to create a contemporary sound, which usually relies on internal rhyme, assonance, and alliteration. And so I began, and as I began, it was a lot of fun. And for the first three lines, I had those 47 helpers, those Virgils. But after that, I wanted to keep going. And so I went to the library and I checked out 20 books in English translations, ranging in time from Longfellow's, the first English translation, 1867, to the most recent one on the shelf, which was Hollander, Robert and Jean Hollander's. And I began to work through Canto One using those helpers to see how other people had approached all the possible choices, and then making my own. And by the time I finished that first canto, I decided I would do the entire book. And I did, and it took 7 years to do that.
It's amazing, and hearing you tell the story puts the expression "in the middle of the road of our lives," or however you want to put it, in a very different light for me. First of all, it reminds us that we're in the middle of the stream of Dante interpretation. Our sense of presentness often leads us to place ourselves at the end of the interpretive lineage. But of course, we're in the middle. There are many others that are coming after us chronologically and culturally. We're in the middle of a tradition that involves Italians, English speakers of different centuries, speaking to one another through the technology of the book. So you undertook a translation by kind of immersing yourself or putting yourself in the middle of lots of other translations and seeing if you could make it your own, I suppose.
Make it my own, but also be rigorously true to the original in terms of what was being said. It was only how it was being said. I wanted to bring it into this moment because Dante clearly wanted his poem to last. And as you know, that's why he chose to write it in the vernacular. He said that literary Latin, the expected language for a long poem, would never change in time. And he wanted the poem to change. So I took that argument as my own and tried to bring it forward into the present time, because everything in that book is still relevant.
I'm thinking of, I mean, there's so many examples. I'll just grab one from Canto 5. "Hey, you who come to the hotel, woe," said Minos when he saw me neglecting for a second his official duties. "Be careful where you go and who you talk to. Don't be fooled by the fact that the door is always open." So this is an attempt at a kind of street talk that sounds like it could come out of 20th century film or whatever. Is that right?
It is. And also
hard-boiled.
Because because Dante is a very filmic book. It's a very novelistic book. And part of that relies on the characters coming to life, and each one speaks differently. But if the translation doesn't allow for that difference in speech, everybody sounds the same.
There's also a sense in which what I take away from your translation is the your attempt to capture the boldness of Dante's address to the reader. In your Inferno, you have, in addition to the verse translation, there's a kind of prose summary of the narrative. It's done in the second person, and it reminded me of Once in a Lifetime by Talking Heads. You know, you may find yourself living in a shotgun shack. You ask yourself, how did I get here? You took up that second person voice to capture the directness of Dante's address to the reader. Is that right?
That's the introduction, yes. And so it kind of lays out the poem in that methodology that you just mentioned. And then that's followed by a note on the translation, which talks about the Bergvall and other aspects of my translation. And then the translation proper begins.
Hearing you go through those different renderings of the opening, I'm very aware of the fact that we have three native Italian speakers just on this panel, and then plenty more in the audience. Not to put any of you three on the spot, but does any of you have those early tercets at hand and we could hear the Italian right now before we go any further just in English? Francesco?
I do. So are we talking about the beginning, canto one?
Is that? Yeah, Mary Jo just went through three or four versions, and the might have been appropriate for me to have you do the Italian first, but here we are.
So the very beginning of the poem goes, nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita mi ritrovai per una selva oscura che la diritta via era smarrita. Ai quanto a dir qual era e cosa dura, e sta selva selvaggia e aspra e forte che nel pensier rinnova la paura. It could go on for 14,000 more lines.
Our Zoom license will not allow for that, but I like the idea very much. So Francesco, you're teaching a course at Georgetown, just began, Dante's Afterlife in Popular Culture. And it's part of the Doyle Seminars, which have a special humanistic aspect. There's still some spots open in the course, I know. I may ask you to audit the course if the dean allows me. But there's obviously so much to say about how Dante bears on our time. And the most obvious question I have for you, but take this in any direction you'd like, is it 90% Inferno and 5% Purgatorio and 5% Paradiso? Or does the afterlife of Dante in popular culture break down differently than that?
No, well, I think you're quite accurate. I teach regular courses on Dante's works, and when I concentrate on the Divine Comedy, usually I try to distribute more equally the three canticles, Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso. However, you already sort of explained why this one course, which is specifically about Dante's afterlife in popular culture, focuses mostly on the Inferno, simply because most artists decided to, or maybe just were more inspired by the Inferno than other canticles or sections of the poem. Therefore, certainly we can, I will definitely read some portions from Paradiso and Purgatorio. For example, one of the, I have props here, I just thought it would be nice to show, rather than you share the screen, which everybody can do. I have the actual props. This, for example, is Paradise by Toni Morrison, which is one of the three books belonging to the epic trilogy that starts with Beloved and then goes on with Jazz. There is an overarching Dantean theme in Toni Morrison, and so we may make some connections. Also, because Paul, you mentioned the Doyle Seminar. The Doyle Seminar funds our courses and allows us to invite speakers. So one of our speakers will be Professor Dennis Looney from the University of Pittsburgh, who wrote a very interesting book on the reception of Dante in African-American writers. And that is not pulp necessarily, but I think it's something that still should be addressed, because pop culture or our contemporary literary culture referring to Dante helps us understand how Dante still is relevant to us today, 700 years after his death. This is Dante's anniversary, the 700th anniversary of Dante's death. So events are being held all over the world to celebrate that and to commemorate and remember his work. But precisely what and why is still current about that? And this is another interesting piece that I can share with you. It's an anime, actually cartoon movie that was produced in 2008. And as you can see from the cover itself, it probably verges more on the splatter or scenic aspect of Dante's Inferno for sure. I think that helps us try to value and discuss what really we want to read through Dante's lines and why we still relate to this amazing book that was written so long ago, but it really is a journey into the human soul. And somebody mentioned it, I believe, politics before. Obviously Dante speaks of his own politics, but he does so in such passionate and current terms that we still are attracted to it when he places popes and emperors in hell, for example. He also places others in paradise, of course, but he has no fear of condemning the really powerful characters of his time. Some of them are still living, by the way, so he exposes himself to retaliation and he takes a few risks. Dante was a man who had lost everything. So I will just conclude saying that pop culture includes many, many areas and many, many arts. So we'll also treat of music. We have a disc by Tangerine Dream, which is a German band of electronic music, but also not many people know that Ai Weiwei, a very famous Chinese visual artist, also has a CD from 2013 titled The Divine Comedy. There's plenty, and there's plenty of opportunity to approach Dante's work from different perspectives.
So, you know, I set you up a bit with this 95-5 formulation that most of popular culture is preoccupied with Inferno or hell. You know, an obvious inference to draw would be that we are preoccupied with the dark side and with violence. But just hearing you speak now, I'm struck by how many archetypal motifs, the kind that are in play in popular culture, are present in Dante. There's the midlife crisis, there's the journey, there's the man battling with beasts. There is the buddy movie, in the sense where the older guide figure ventures forth with the younger adept and they kind of figure out a truth together. There's, I want to say, even the sequel and the second sequel with the Purgatorio and Paradiso. Are these things also in part of what popular culture recognizes as its own in some respect in Dante?
I would definitely say so, yes. And perhaps the most striking feature that also is the subject of so much popular culture is recasting the notions of absolute good and absolute evil. As you seem to suggest, Paul, perhaps absolute evil is more, at least more immediate in the way that we experience it and we represent it. So Inferno is more successful. There's also an intrinsic reason. Dante gets very doctrinal and very abstract in the Paradiso, and the Inferno is a little more of, there's more action and there's more imagery. So it's easier to access and to understand. But these notions of absolute good and evil that we still grapple with today can most profitably be read and discussed from Dante's work, and if, especially if we look at it with this popular culture notion, because we find that, as you said, you know, the struggle of men with beasts, for example, or the encounter of the human, of a living human who descends into hell with Satan. How is a living person going to relation himself or herself with the embodiment of evil? The English speakers may have in mind Milton's Lucifer, which is a figure larger than life, and it's a titanic protagonist. When we get to meet Dante, Satan, in canto 34 of Inferno, the last canto, we don't see that greatness and that grandeur. Actually, we may be disappointed at seeing how Lucifer is little more than a huge windmill, that's the expression that Dante uses, stuck in the middle of the earth. But we are terrified, on the other hand, at meeting the souls of sinners in hell. Those are much more scary to us because we look like them and they look like us more than the devil does.
I love the point that you make that Satan is a diminished thing, and this is maybe part of Dante's sense of things and his Catholic sense of things, that on earth and in the realm of temptation, Satan looms large, but in the afterlife, something different obtains. You mentioned how the theology can seem to go progressively thicker and denser in the Purgatorio and the Paradiso. And Vittorio, one of the things that struck me about your work in your book on Dante as theology is how you moved, in my experience, and correct me if I'm wrong, so thoroughly off the grid of Thomism and Neo-Thomism that pervades the discussion of Dante as theology, and onto a set of terms that are personally congenial to me, but also that speaks so directly to the experience of the reader, the experience of encounter, the experience of divinations through self-reform and self-improvement, the experience of love as the force by which these things take place, and the way, you know, you put it this way, in a with striking power, Dante loves us and wants us to be changed and even to be saved through his text. Am I getting that shift correctly? And can you expound on it a bit? You're a professor at King's College, the University of London, and you're holding a second appointment now. Is that right?
Yes, I teach at King's College London, Religion and the Arts. And I'm also currently acting director of the von Hugel Institute in Cambridge, Institute for Critical Catholic Inquiry. I spend most of my time working on Dante, and as you said, Paul, and thank you very much for this invitation and for putting together this wonderful event. Really interested in how we can think of the form of Dante's text as theology. So thinking about the way Dante writes narrative poetry as essential to his way of doing theology. So not as an ornament, but as sort of inviting us to reflect on story and the kind of story that Dante gives us as theology. And for all their differences, between the three cantiche, Inferno, Purgatorio, Paradiso, for all their differences, one thing that remains constant is human encounter. This is a story that is told in and through a series of human encounters. And one of the things that I'm fascinated by and is the way in which Dante seems to want to do theology in and through the particularity of human encounter. So while on one hand, the journey in the Paradiso gets more ethereal, more abstract, perhaps, it still retains that sense of embodied particularity in some ways that are quite dazzling. And I was thinking of the title of our event today, you know, Dante, Searcher and Discoverer. One particular point in the Paradiso came to mind that for me captures Dante's theology. I often like to say that these are the most important lines of the whole poem. And of course, any statement like that is shouldn't be made, but I make it anyway, just to to convey a point. So this is in Paradiso 21, and this is the heaven of Saturn. They have journeyed, they being Dante and Beatrice, have already journeyed through a number of heavens. A marker of Dante's progress has been the increasing beauty of Beatrice's smile. But when they reach the heaven of Saturn, she doesn't smile. The smile would be too beautiful. It would incinerate Dante at that point. He wouldn't be able to confront it. For the same reason, at that point, the music stops, and Francesco can tell us much more about that. And it'd be wonderful to hear him speak about that. So there's this, suddenly Beatrice is not smiling. There is no music. And only one of the blessed comes to greet them at that point. And Dante wants to know why it is only one person that comes to greet them. So, and already that singularity emphasizes that sense of particularity. And so he asks this blessed human being, why is it only you that comes to greet us? And the only response Dante gets at that point is, well, we move in love and we are in accord with divine love, and this is why I'm here. And Dante says, yes, 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 I've been told that kind of thing before, but why you? And clearly Dante doesn't get it yet. And so he gets a longer explanation, basically reasserting the point. And something clicks at that point in Dante. And he says, you know, in the Italian, si mi prescrisser le parole sue, ch'io lasciai la questione e mi ritrassi a dimandarla umilmente chi fue. You know, his words so hit me that I held back my questions and humbly asked him who he was. Dante was so interested in figuring out how God works, figuring out why this particular person had been appointed to meet them. He's so interested in getting an answer to how divinity works. He hadn't asked the person before him who he was. And then he gets it. That's the first question to ask. That's how you encounter divinity. And indeed, this blessed human being, who turns out to be Peter Damian, had explained to Dante that those kind of answers are not available to the human mind. We all participate in divine love. We can't understand it with that degree of objectivity that Dante is searching for, because we would need to stand outside it, and that's impossible. No creature can do that. That's the error of Lucifer. That's what Peter Damian says. And so there's this moment in the Paradiso that is very concrete, very particular, embodied. The journey towards God is the journey of humbly asking those we encounter on our way who they are, listening to them on their own terms, not our own. And one of the reasons I say that this is the most important line of some of the most important lines of the poem is that I think we can take these words as kind of theological justification for the way Dante writes. That's why human encounter is so central. This is theology done in and through that sense of particularity.
It's very powerful to hear you spell it out that way. I asked him who he was, because the plain spoken expression sounds to me, it seems to echo the Gospels somehow. Mm-hmm. Not to put the point too strongly, but the emphasis on particularity in Dante is very bound up with our understanding of him, I think, as a Christian poet. I remember reading, but also as a proto-modern poet, in graduate school, I wrote an essay on Dante's portrait of Francis of Assisi, contrasting it with the two portraits done by St. Bonaventure. And St. Bonaventure's are schematic, and they're set out according to catalogs of the virtues. And Dante's is a perfectly etched portrait that also has tremendous narrative drive. And to see the intense particularity of Dante in comparison with a rough contemporary, Bonaventure, whose portrait is so much less particular, is to realize the kind of great leap into particularity that's taken through Dante's work. I guess if it would suit you, I'd like to kind of wind the point backward through the group, because each of you has given such attention to Dante's particularity. Vittorio, you could speak in any direction, but I am struck reading your great book on Dante, how he seems to have a particular reader in mind, or he seems to focus his text not for a general audience, but so that it reaches readers individually. Francesco, you have written about the way Dante has treated music in each of the three parts, so that there's a progression that's both logical and pleasing to this treatment of very particular types of music. I'm just in awe of the very idea and want to know if he fully intended it or whether it was just part of him or what. And then Mary Jo, you suggested that Dante was determined that his work would last. And if I'm getting things right for all of you, the paradox of Dante is that he wagered that intense particularity would paradoxically make the work last better than if he streamlined it for posterity. A lot to digest there, but Vittorio, can you kind of wind things back in the other direction now?
Certainly. So the sense of particularity is extremely important, and I really like the way you put it. Dante is not speaking to readers in general; he is speaking to readers in particular. So he seems to write in a way that wants to reach everyone. You might say humanity as a whole, but not humanity in general, humanity in particular. He wants to reach you and me and each particular human being. And of course, you know, one could say that, well, but he writes in a language that at the time wasn't, you know, was particular and wasn't universal. You know, he chooses his vernacular as opposed, and so you might say he excludes other vernacular, but you can see from the 14th century onwards, that commitment to particularity encourages people to want to translate it and try and make their own particularity out of it. So I think it's really important. I loved in the translation you read at the beginning, Mary Jo, I'm not sure I captured it exactly, but what we call life, right? And I love that sense that, and for each of us, that will be slightly different. It will resonate slightly different. But that active engagement of our imagination through, you know, asking ourselves, how is it that we name things? What do we call life? Dante, through his commitment to particularity, seems to find ways that we can each address those questions of universal import that are important for us to address, both individually and as a community. And I would connect this to what I was saying earlier about the way that Dante writes narrative poetry and seems to want to do theology through it. That where theology for Dante is not an abstract exercise. It puts us in play. You know, these are matters that are of great importance, of essential importance, of vital importance. And we need to ask the questions and in and through our encounters with each other.
Along the journey of our life. Hearing you explain it that way, that what we call life, it's almost like an invitation. And when we come back to you, Mary Jo, I hope you can speak to this, how even those of us who are not translators are invited to translate or to find points of contact between what I call life and what Dante calls life and what the various interlocutors call life. And so a general or question of what life is already being raised. Then that schema then is complicated by the material that you deal with, Francesco, in that if we were saying what we call music, I mean, he's focused on specific musical traditions that he strands through the Commedia that belong to his culture and historical epoch and not to others. Isn't that right? And that's what you've been able to draw out in your scholarship?
Yes. There are so many references to music in the Commedia that it is hardly possible to ignore them or not consider them seriously for the general, for the overall interpretation of the book, in my opinion, at least. And there are so many different musical situations, and now I'm starting to use the term musical now in a broader sense that I did in the past, because as you pointed out, I started out studying references to singing, especially, particularly Gregorian chant, which abounds in Purgatory. And even in Inferno, though, the few references to Gregorian chant that we encounter in Inferno are of a parodic nature, meaning that Dante reverses or distorts those references to Gregorian chant, or at least to ecclesiastical music, to use a broader term. So for example, precisely when Dante encounters Lucifer, Virgil opens up Canto 34 of Inferno by quoting a hymn from the 6th century, which was composed by the bishop of the French city of Poitiers, whose name was Venantius Fortunatus, Vexilla Regis Prondeunt, which in Latin means the banners of the king of hell are of the king are coming forward. Excuse me, there's no hell in the original hymn, but that's precisely the addition that Dante makes to that hymn, Vexilla Regis Prodeunt Inferni. So the banners of the king of hell are coming forward. And that gives you an idea of how Dante distorts purposefully songs and singing that were known to everyone of his medieval audience. As Vittorio was pointing out before, Dante would reach individuals, however, also addressing the common knowledge, the sort of common denominator that every reader in the Middle Ages would share, was the knowledge by heart, I would say, of certain songs. Gregorian chant or certain particularly famous liturgical hymns were in the mind of everyone who would read Dante's poem. And so Dante uses that knowledge. He doesn't need to go beyond the first line. Elsewhere, for example, he quotes a psalm, and many psalms were indeed almost inseparable from a musical performance. The way that they were usually recited was at least cantillated, if not outright sung or set to sometimes even polyphonic settings. I was thinking now of in Exit to Israel de Egipto, which is it's Psalm 113, and it's about the Israelites coming out of Israel to the promised land. This is obviously symbolic of the souls who are abandoning mortal life to access purgatory, which is in itself a promise to the beatitude in paradise. So Dante uses all those references, which are inherently musical, to evoke not only just to express rational ideas, but also to evoke something that is otherwise not conveyable through words. That takes place significantly in Paradise. In the Paradise, Dante has to rely on the evocative power of music to try to pull out of the sounds, which is something that Mary Jo was referring to at the beginning. As a translator, of course, that is a particularly important aspect of her activity, and a poet always places great emphasis on sound. And when we read the text in translation, sometimes I have the students read the Italian in the parallel text, because I just want to expose them to what Dante heard and wanted us to hear. And so when Dante describes or evokes a song, especially in the Paradiso, he wants us to actually hear that music. And as readers from the 21st century now, we sort of probably forgot those original musics, but it would be great to go and do some research to hear those melodies or polyphonies again, because in Paradiso, we do find some polyphonies that Dante refers to. And I don't know if you could hear that, but my cat is just throwing his two cents in and he's starting to sing. So it's probably my signal to stop here, but that's good for music as well.
So there's all this music in the Commedia. Did Dante, to what extent is it itself a piece of music or a song? I'm thinking of Virgil, of arms and the man I sing. That's the opening of the Aeneid.
Sorry, some of your words, I'm sorry.
The Aeneid and the opening lines of the Aeneid announce the work as a song, of arms and the man I sing.
Dante's his units, his chapters, or cantica, the three sections. So obviously the notions of poetry, versification, and music itself are interwoven, interconnected. It's so deep and so old that it can hardly...
Because of the word canto, meaning what is canto as a musical connotation, is that right?
It does. Dante obviously wrote his poem for reading, not for performing. But I sometimes wonder myself whether he anticipated the enormous success that his poem actually had in terms of being set to music or in terms of being recited and performed. I think he might have at least desired to an extent that in addition to just reading, which is something that we cannot make without. I mean, the Dante's comedy is so thick in meaning, so complex that we have to have the written text to understand it properly. But then that is not enough. I think the performance and the rumination, to use a word that was popular in medieval performance theory, rumination is what cows do with grass for food, but it's also what the monks would do with the words of the Gregorian repertory. They would ruminate them in their minds. They would keep them in their mouths and minds for a long time so that they would at some point bear fruits of a spiritual nature.
When you put it that way, it sounds very much what scholars who devote decades to certain works must do. That, you know, I in my work have the luxury of moving around from text to text and author to author, but you all have spent serious time with this one author. Mary Jo, when we're still talking about particularity, and in your introduction, you state very clearly some of the objectives you had in choosing a particularity of a certain kind, contemporary idiom and figures of speech and metaphors and so forth. But with what Francesco was saying, did you also is sound and the possibility of music also part of your process?
Absolutely. And in terms of the what you were saying about the particularity, this is something that poets know, that to get to the universal, you have to go through the particular. You can't just throw out abstract nouns like love and, hate. They mean nothing because they mean something different to everybody. If you say love, it's like if you say a chair, somebody's going to think of a kitchen chair, somebody's going to think of a wingback chair, somebody's going to think of a lounge chair. So the same, it becomes even more difficult with large abstract nouns. And so the idea of poetry is to embody that emotion or that state of being, that consciousness in something that someone else can look at and have this empathic identification. It's almost like a narcissistic mirroring. So it's really the poet, but if the poet does it well, they almost pixelate their own picture so that you, the reader, looking at that poem, see yourself in it. And those poems that often don't work are poems that are overburdened with too much specificity so that we don't see ourselves, we only see the poet. And that's a dance that the poet does. And I think that Dante knows this and he knows it so well that that's part of the success of this poem, the sense of verisimilitude, this sense of looking at a character and saying, I know that kind of character. Yeah, the particulars are slightly different, but only slightly. I know who says things like that. I know who acts like that. And you see that person now being punished in hell or paying back their debt for that bad behavior in purgatory. And you know it's true. There's a sense of truth to it. And that's how that truth is created in poetry, in literature in general, is through these particulars. And that's why we keep translating this poem, that's why we keep reading the poem. I also wanted to say that I know the poem is deeply invested in the theology, but I feel that, and I'd love to know what Francesco and Vittorio think about this. I think that Dante is at least as concerned, if not more, with the social fabric of the living. And it's the destruction of that social fabric that he is very concerned with, because he's been a victim of it. And so, yes, he wants everyone to be saved because he's a Catholic and he believes in Catholicism, but not, he believes in the faith of it, not necessarily the organized religion, which he finds a lot of corruption in. So I think that this ability to create a social fabric that we can believe in is essential so that we can see what happens when there are ruptures, what happens out of envy, pride, all of the cardinal sins. It disturbs the social fabric, and unless there's somebody at the top of the church, the top of the state, who's not corrupt, then, you know, they don't create any kind of example for other people. And so he wants to bring attention to the fact that the leadership has to be something that models good behavior, not just for the afterlife, for this life.
I'm going to let the other two respond to that question. It's in effect, you're suggesting that the lack of order or lack of justice or lack of fairness that Dante felt in the rended social order of his time led him to constitute an orderly social order which justice was meted out appropriately in his poem. Well, they respond, I'm sure with a moment's reflection, you'll have at hand an instance from one of your translations where you sought to carry over a specific detail or particular from Dante in a way that would have the kind of resonance for the reader that you just described. Can you kind of find an episode that shows us what you mean? Meanwhile, Vittorio and Francesco, either of you with a response to this proposition about Dante and the rended social order?
Sure, that actually makes me think, and I'll just throw this, I just want to mention another work by Dante, which is possibly less famous than the Commedia, Monarchia, on monarchy. He wrote that possibly around 1312 or 1319, there's debate among scholars, but it's an important political work because in it, Dante clearly states that the emperor's job, basically, or the political role of the empire is to provide social conditions for people to live morally. And if those conditions are not met, then the empire essentially fails in its role, in its historical role, which is to make a society on earth that allows Christians to live in a Christian way.
Vittorio?
Yes, I would say, in response to the really important question, I would say yes, but for Dante, the two are one. And I go back again to why does Dante choose to do theology the way he does with this story built in and through human encounter? Because for him, you can't separate the two. The thinking about what it means to journey towards God is to think about how we live together here, not in the afterlife, but here. And you know, we can think of a number of points in the poem where this unity is shown. We can think, for example, of the Cantos of the Heaven of Jupiter, where, you know, justice is center stage in more ways than one, but also the question of salvation is center stage. And Dante, the blessed human beings that Dante meets there are rulers in significant measure, and not all of them Christian. Not all of the figures Dante sees there are Christian. Well, they Dante, for example, sees in the heaven of Jupiter the Emperor Trajan, who, according to legend, was allowed to come out of hell because of the prayers of Pope Gregory the Great, believed and was saved. But I think one of the points that Dante is making in that canto is that ultimately notions of divine justice and divine love go together. They transcend human categories by which we think we are able to judge who's in and who's out. And in setting these questions before us, Dante is ultimately setting before us the question of how do we live together? How do we judge one another? How do we love one another? Are the two questions for Dante ultimately are one. And it is in that canto that Dante, in that episode, that Dante gives us, I think one of the most striking passages, I've said it again, but he sees the blessed of the heaven of Jupiter forming the shape of an eagle. And he says, and then at one point I saw something that something that no one has ever seen. It's so extraordinary. This single eagle was composed by many human beings. It should have spoken in the plural, and yet it speaks in the singular. And Dante then uses that same language, the language of grammar in a way, to refer to the Trinity. And you can speak of the Trinity in singular and plural. And that connection, to me, suggests that for Dante, the way in which human beings can retain the particularity and yet be one, here and now, in justice, for Dante, is at one with divine love, most perfectly and eternally in the Trinity. So we could go on and on, but I think you raise a really important question, and the way I would explore it is to really think about how, for Dante, the concern with how human beings live justly here and now is one with the his theological concerns.
Indeed, if I may append just a very quick consideration of a musical nature to what Vittorio has said, I'm thinking of Canto 10 of Paradiso, where two groups of blessed souls, one gathered around the Dominican St. Thomas and the other one gathered around the Franciscan St. Bonaventure, who praise each other's saints, virtues, of course. That is a very musical moment, especially at the end of the canto, because Dante describes their dancing. So there isn't only music being sung out, but also dance being performed by saints and theologians. It's the dance of the theologians. And that is a political metaphor and a social metaphor, because as we know, Franciscans and Dominicans would disagree on many theological points, and sometimes these disagreements were quite bitter. But in that moment, they are described as a one big choreography, similar to the cogs of a clock that dance and sing in perfect harmony. So it's a marvelous spectacle that the poet uses to express in visual and musical terms that reflects how society, and in this case, particularly the society of theologians and intellectuals, is composed by individuals who have different ideas. They may disagree, but they can still sing in harmony if they learn to do that, and they do in paradise, of course, they can do that.
It's a tremendous image, the dance of the theologians, the dance of the mystics, the dance of the saints. What I'm noticing too is how maybe this is not true of discussion of Dante, but I suspect that it is. The conversations always wind up in the present tense, such as the confidence that lovers of Dante have of the pertinence of Dante to our time. I want to hear this instance of particularity from Mary Jo's translation, but as a to kind of round out the general discussion before we turn to a few questions from the audience, I would invite each of you to think about how you might reflect for a moment on this experience that you have, or the sureness that you seem to have of Dante as our contemporary, because it's so clear hearing you speak that so many of the anxieties that humanists have about the status of their subject in the present time doesn't seem to be there. We're just so confident about Dante. And I'd love to hear you all speak about that. Mary Jo, so you spoke so powerfully about the attention to the particular that is the at the heart of the poet's work. Was there a passage that where this was a special challenge, or that you can present to us now?
Well, I don't know that there was a special passage. Throughout, I tried to find equivalences from our own culture as a way to suggest that this is taking place now, that there was no break in time from the time that Dante wrote this, or the beginning of time, until the present. So one place was where a boat is described, the boat that Chiron is using to take the souls to hell proper, it comes as fast as an arrow. And we don't have a close relationship to arrows in our culture, unless you're an archer, and, you know, but how many of us are? And so I thought, well, what's a better metaphor or a simile for speed? And then what popped into my head was faster than a speeding bullet, which is, of course, what Superman is described as. But that was it would put Superman center stage, and there's, I didn't
know other associations or whatever.
It would be more like a parody. And so I kept thinking, and I went to the internet to see about speed and how fast different things were compared to arrows. And I found mention of a car, a production car called the Ultimate Arrow, A-E-R-O. And of course, cars and race cars and even the glossy ads in magazines for these cars are so ubiquitous in our society that the boat is as fast as an ultimate arrow. And what I was doing there was embodying in the medieval arrow. And so whenever I would make these substitutions, they had to embody the original. There's a place where a peasant goes with a cart. It's a simile, like a peasant with a cart. And you know, how many of us have a relationship to peasants and carts, even though there may be some still in the world? But if you're a farmer, you go you know, in a car or a tractor or pickup truck to the field. And so I kept thinking, is the peasant going to be a farmer? But the peasant is actually a subset of the category of a worker. And similarly, a worker gets up, sees that there's snow, and worries about how they're going to get to work. And so this cart becomes a car. And again, obviously, the word C-A-R is in C-A-R-T. So I kept trying to be rigorous in terms of that embodiment, but at the same time, to create a world that is like our own, that has our own specificity and particularity, so that it would have this sense of a reality, of something that we could actually see and see ourselves in.
So how did that simile come out? I'm dying to hear it now.
Which one?
The worker and his or her car.
I'd have to look it up, and that would take too much time. But, you know, throughout, that's what I've tried to do. I'm now working on Paradiso, and it's much harder to, because it's so thinky, that it's much harder to find opportunities for introducing objects or anything contemporary. And I'm just finished Canto 5, so I'll keep trying, but I wonder if I'll be able to do the same thing with Paradiso.
Here's hoping so, and I know that the experience of the translator is often that of a problem solver. I worked with Robert Pinsky on his translation, and he described having ballpoint pen ink stains on his pillow because he would take one last problem of translation to bed at night, thinking that he'd let the unconscious work on it and wake up with an answer in the morning.
Well, it's so true. I'm often kept awake or wake up in the middle of the night thinking about a word equivalence.
And then I know, Vittorio, you in your book refer to a couple of cruxes or problems that have haunted Dante scholarship for a century, I think. I'm thinking of the question of the fourfold interpretation and how pertinent that is to the book, and also what is the significance of the literal sense. So this is a kind of thing that scholars are in conversation with across decades and across languages when they're discussing Dante, is that right?
Yes, I mean, the question of how to interpret Dante's poetry, how to interpret Dante's poetry relative to, say, how scripture was interpreted, has in various forms been a question that has certainly kept Dante scholars busy. One way in which I think this question can be very relevant for us today in our conversation now, but also more generally in our contemporary setting, is that on one hand, we can explore that question in a very technical way, thinking about the different ways in which in the Middle Ages, different senses of scripture were thought of, etc. At the root of that question, I think that the root of that question is a concern with the relationship between the text we have on the page, history, and spiritual truth. And one of the challenges that Dante presents us with in writing the way he does is the challenge of gradually undermining easy distinctions between truth and fiction. And so that the engagement with Dante's text relative to spiritual truth comes in and through a fiction that is so realistic in a way that does raise the question about itself, whether Dante intends us to interpret it literally in the sense of historically. But I think Dante also invites us to go beyond that and ask ourselves again about the value of that rich embodied particularity that the text presents us with, and how it can, that encounter with particularity can awaken us to spiritual truths. And I think often in a scholarly setting, we can get sort of trapped in ideas and we try and map things out. So at this particular point, Dante is inviting us to read his text in this way, and that we can relate to the this kind of medieval notion of reading. At this point, we can do something slightly different. I think it's important to, while doing all that, to retain that sense of living energy that the text presents us with in terms of how it places itself as fiction in history. Dante, a particular human person, inserting his voice in the flux of history. Paul, I loved your comment earlier. We're always in the middle of that flux. Dante knew that well. That's, as Mary Jo was suggesting, that's part of his reason for writing in the vernacular, so that his language is part of that change, part of that flux, the flux of history. He writes the richly embodied particular fiction that he writes as his intervention in history that we can encounter in our own embodied sort of particularity. And by doing that, he has written a text that does awaken us spiritually to the point that we ask, is it meaningful to read it in the way that we read scripture? But that question, I think, is in a way secondary to that living presence of the text in the world.
And all that you just said, in a way, is an answer to my question about how Dante is contemporary. Historical work, yes, we have to be aware of that. It's an imaginative work, and in some ways that are very difficult to understand, it's transhistorical in the way that the imagination is. We read it in a historically conditioned set of circumstances that are different from those of some predecessors who have read it. And yet, all that said, we must read it here and now for ourselves, open to its ability to speak to us personally, diminishing all the issues that you and I have just articulated, but those don't scramble the signal of the text speaking to us here and now as an individual reader. All those things are in play together, and this is what gives the text its power in as a contemporary text. Is that right?
Yes, I think so. And it's that capacity of being true to its own historical context, and in and through that, being true to our own, that is remarkable. I see there's a comment in the Q&A you were inviting us to look at those about, yes, you know, on Primo Levi, you know, and Primo Levi's encounter with Dante in Auschwitz, which I think is one of the most extraordinary moments in perhaps in the whole of literature, you know, an extraordinary human encounter between an Italian Jewish chemist, atheist in Auschwitz with Dante's medieval Christian theological poetry, an encounter that, you know, brings Levi to interpret Dante in his own way as part of his history at that moment, in a way that intersects history in so many other complex and problematic ways. Yesterday was Holocaust Memorial Day, and Dante's text sadly presents us with instances of prejudice against Judaism. Dante's language was taken up by fascism in Levi's own time as well. And yet at the same time, there's a particularity in the text, a capacity in the text to speak to us and awaken us to our shared search for truth and for community and friendship and love that transcends ideologies. And to see that happening in the encounter between Primo Levi and Dante in Auschwitz is powerful and moving, and I think can be given as another example of how the questions we're exploring in our conversation today can actually play out in history and have a real life-giving impact in particular lives.
So that there hardly a more specific historical instance than to be Primo Levi in the lager. That's as historically specific as we can get. And Dante's power to speak to that particular circumstance in a way that Levi could not only grasp, but could use as generative in his whole body of work is just one instance of this, the power of Dante.
And gives us a sense of this sort of also of this almost inexhaustible mystery that there can be in particular human encounters from across time, space, cultures, traditions. Yeah, sorry, Francesco.
Well, I was just going to make more explicit what you already said, I think, Vittorio, that there is this strong connection between Dante's Inferno and Primo Levi's depiction of Auschwitz, especially when we consider that Primo Levi dedicated an entire chapter called Il Canto di Ulisse to Dante's Canto 26 of Inferno. It's even more interesting when we connect this to the relation between poetry, fiction, and reality that we were discussing before, because it has been observed that the first edition of Primo Levi's Se questo è un uomo, dating back to 1947, was for a small publishing house from Turin, and it did not include that chapter. So, and that chapter was later included in 1958 in the Einaudi edition. The co-protagonist of that episode, Jean, nicknamed Piccolo, was later interviewed, and he had no recollection of the episode that, that Levi described, Primo telling the story of Ulysses as told in Dante to Jean and translating it on the spot into French for his understanding. When interviewed, Jean Piccolo said he had no recollection. So we are left with, you know, the lingering question, did Primo Levi really, did this really happen? And did it happen in the terms that Primo Levi described and told in the 1958 edition of Se questo è un uomo? Or to what extent did Primo fictionalized this episode, and how does that fit into a work that is considered and is a work of a historical witness? These questions all connect, I believe, to the genre, if we may, and the nature of Dante's Divine Comedy, when Dante claims that he was indeed in hell and heaven, I believe it was Charles Singleton who pointed out that the greatest claim and the greatest challenge, the greatest fiction of Dante's poem is indeed to claim that it is not fiction at all. So how do we relate to the text? What is the text's claim to reality and realism, right? And does that even matter, and to what extent for the witnessing of an experience that is unique and vital for the human being?
Right, Dante's creating scenarios in which he, two people in hell, one guy is telling the other how it was for him. And there's an element of stage manager or contrivance in it that is very powerful, but also undeniable, I suppose. I just want to pick up a couple of questions from the chat that you could respond to generally or particularly. One is the question of the genre of commedia dell'anime, having to do with the spirit or soul, and how this bears on Dante's work. Another, I'm sure each of you is asked all the time, do you have favorite translations or favorite go-to texts on Dante that you can recommend to the rest of us? I mean, Mary Jo, you went from 47 to 20 to how many are you using for the Purgatorio and now for the Paradiso?
Yeah, there is one that I can recommend. It's fascinating. It was first done in the late 1800s. And the, excuse me, third edition, the latest edition, was in 1903. And it's by William Vernon. And it's called Readings on the, and then Inferno, Purgatorio, Paradiso. So Readings on the Inferno of Dante, comma, chiefly based on the commentary of Benvenuto da Imola. And what he does is, it's a prose translation, but he interrogates every word in it and then traces the commentary back to the 1300s. And he'll say, Benvenuto said it meant this, but later so-and-so found this out. And then, you know, my father, his father was a Dantist. My father went to Florence and he spoke to the great Florentine Dantist, who said, only in Florence did this word mean X. And then he uses that word, but then later translations don't. And so it's fascinating to see what sticks in terms of commentary and what doesn't. So I love reading it, and it's been extremely useful to me.
Vittorio, you've given a lot of attention to Roberto Benigni and his work on Dante, which I suppose is known to you also, Francesco. Not to put you on the spot, but is that, I was surprised by the just the heft and power that you suggest that Benigni's work has. What is it about his work on Dante that's so powerful?
I find in Benigni's reading.
This is the actor Benigni, by the way, the Italian actor, right?
Yeah. That what I find particularly powerful is the way in which, with his enthusiasm as a comedian, Benigni, in his readings of Dante, presented in public squares with thousands of people watching, you know, he constantly wishes to point his audiences to the spiritual energy of Dante's text, not as in contrast with the comic or more everyday or more popular aspects of the poem, but as one with it. And this is something you find time and time again in his readings. And he takes it quite, he's prepared to take it, you know, quite quite far. You know, he says things like, we really have to believe that Dante went on the journey he tells us he went on. We really have to believe that, not because God exists, but so that God may be, in the sense that so that we can awaken to divinity. This is not a journey that describes how things are, but it's a journey that invites us to participate in how things are and in what things can be if we transform our lives. And so to me, it's fascinating to see a figure like Benigni emphasizing these aspects of Dante's of Dante's poetry. And I've been fascinated sort of more recently to, for example, you know, Benigni was invited to speak at an event in Rome on, I forget the exact details, but on Pope Francis's book, you know, The Name of God is Mercy. And with that same kind of enthusiasm was speaking of the importance of joy in mercy and connecting that to stories in the Gospels. You were I'm picking up, Paul, on something you were saying earlier, you know, Dante's text, you know, when Dante asked, I, and I asked him who he was, recalling a, recalling Jesus's sort of question, you know, who do you say that I am? Sorry, I'm bringing many things together here, but to emphasize how in the way that Benigni speaks about Dante, we recognize again a commitment to that, in this case, joyous particularity of encounter in which we do naturally have compassion and mercy towards, towards others. And I find that sort of remarkable that even in our time, our troubled times, there is a space in our culture for a phenomenon like this, a public reading of Dante that emphasizes all of these things that perhaps put in a more, in a different way, we might say are countercultural perhaps. But I think Benigni has you know, has found a way of making the text speak in these powerful ways. And I find that quite, quite attractive.
When you're talking about Benigni, it reminds me of something that's so easy to forget, I think. There's one area of experience that we're all equally in the dark about. It's the life beyond this one. And it's easy to forget that Dante had no more direct experience of the afterlife than any of us, that it was just a tremendous act of the imagination. When I think of the imagination outside of Dante, I'm the author of a book about the music of Bach, and he has a cantata, Christlagen Todesbanden, where Christ descends to hell. And it's just the most remarkably vivid account of a descent to hell that I know. Francesco, is there, you know, is there a, what's the best Danteist hell that you know, or is there something you can point us toward where some artist from the culture who's really got it and nailed Dante so that we can go and see or hear what it's like?
You mean in terms of musical adaptations?
Or popular culture. I know you're the man on this. I want to know who really gets Dante and carries it over into other media with special power.
Well, I think that question, the answer to that question may change every time at every given point in history, because one particular aspect of popular culture is to be current and to try to present in current terms what is otherwise a classic, you know, and a universal. Right now, I'm enjoying thoroughly comic books, and let me just show you two more props if I have the chance. I like this one, which is kind of interesting. Hunt Emerson is the author of it, and it's sometimes silly, but it's fun, and I think it speaks to. It's quite faithful in many ways, while it takes liberties from Dante's text. But maybe when it comes to comics, the real classic is Gonagai's manga. Gonagai, for the Italian audience, is also the one who created Goldrake. My generation, if you grew up in the 1970s in Italy, you would know that. It's a big robo cartoon, etc. But this one is from 1971, so it's pretty old, and it's comics with extremely interesting art, and it's realistic, and it's very faithful to the original. I think Gonagai did a good job here of adapting to comics, at least. Once again, I'm sorry I don't have a precise and short answer to your question, Paul. I think, once again, every time we take it from a different perspective, we may find a different answer to your question, which is a great one, precisely because it opens up to so many scenarios.
What your answer is very satisfying. Seeing those books makes me want to be back in Rome at Minimum Facts or Fahrenheit, two favorite bookstores of mine in Rome, which would probably carry that work. And I'll get it and improve my Italian thereby. Before Deborah will make some final remarks, but before she does, is there any last remarks on your part, Mary Jo?
No, I don't think so. I think this has been a really nice mix of the different approaches, the different things that are available within Dante, and he's such a rich source of all of these things that can take the mind in different directions. Music, art, religion, human goodness.
I'm glad you think so. I just got a note just to make sure. Francesco, do you want to give a number for your course here? Or it's
yes.
Dante's Afterlife in Popular Culture.
It's Italian 383, Dante's Afterlife in Popular Culture.
And as I say, I'm going to check with the dean and see if I can sneak in. Deborah, over to you. But first of all, Vittorio, Francesco, Mary Jo, this has been such a pleasure and really an honor, and I can't believe I get to be enriched in the middle of the day through three of you at once. It's really almost overwhelming, but it's going to send me back to Dante as soon as possible. Over to you, Deborah.
Thank you so much, everyone. I am really grateful to you. In some way, you showed that everyone can have his own experience of Dante, and you really broaden our horizons on Dante. So thank you so much, and thank you, Paul. Thank you to the audience.